Welcome to the Asia Society. I'm Kevin Rudd. I'm the president of the Asia Society Policy Institute. 2 years old, our very own think tank. We've been around for 60 years as an institution. The Asia Society itself, its mission statement, building bridges between the United States and the various countries of Asia. And more recently, we've sought to do that in the public policy domain, not just our traditional domains of education, exchange, and culture. So we're delighted to be hosting this evening's event entitled Policymaking in Turbulent Times, the Role of Think Tanks. We'll have the panelists introduced to you in a minute, and I'll be inviting Jim McGann to the stage as well. But the bottom line is we all find ourselves, as we think about public policy, both within government and outside, in a whole new age. I've been a practitioner in political office. What's the characteristics of all political and policy practitioners that I know around the world? They are time poor. Their ability to read anything is circumscribed by the nature of day-to-day political survival. Secondly, who do they rely upon to do their reading and their policy analysis for them? Given that the further constraint within systems of government around day-to-day political survival is, who can help me survive the next 24 hours? And I'll have those guys and girls around me, as opposed to those who might be thinking about medium, long-term, or even short-term policy challenges. And so even those around you, whether it's in the Chancellor's office, the Prime Minister's office, or the White House, let alone in the associated agencies of state, then find themselves engaged again in day-to-day political management, day-to-day policy crisis management, as opposed to the core policy agenda of governments around the world. And so we're in the midst of that morass, which we call contemporary democratic politics, is the role of think tanks actually fit? I'm a sort of guy who's always enjoyed the world of ideas as an end in itself. Ideas as a source of policy and measurement of ideas and policy in action, constituting what we fondly called evidence-based policy. But bringing these two worlds together now, democratic political projects under threat, under pressure, under challenge on the one hand, and objective policy challenges of vast complexity and interrelatedness, and the world of think tankery, which has evolved around different political paradigms over recent decades. What therefore is the future of this industry? What's the future of its engagement with the future public policy debates of the United States and the wider world? So it gives me great pleasure now to invite to the podium Jim McGann, the director of the University of Pennsylvania, UPenn, I gather is what I call that in the United States, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
As opposed to UPenn?
Or Penn State, which is often the case.
Okay. Well, UPenn, Think Tanks and Civil Societies program. And as a reflection of the proliferation of this industry in recent decades, we now have people who professionally study the likes of these think tanks and also have the temerity to put out rankings as to which of us may be doing best, second best, or third best, or worse around the world. Today, they've launched their 2016 Global Go-To Think Tank Index report, the 10th annual ranking exercise they've done, covering 6,500 think tanks worldwide. So, Jim, over to you. Tell us how the evening's going to run, and I look forward to making some concluding remarks later in the evening and about think tanks on the way through. Over to you, Jim.
Evan, thank you very much. I want to welcome all of you to the global launch, and the this is part of a global series of events that are taking place today in 70 cities around the world. And in each one of these cities, they're exploring why think tanks are more important today than ever before. You might think that that's a critical question in the U.S., but it is also a critical question in other cities and countries around the world. I was struck in terms of this week, received a note from the Middle East Research Institute in Erbil, Iraq, who was is organizing or has now organized the program today, and declared as a part of their program International Think Tank Day. So you are participating in International Think Tank Day. The objective of these is to create a sense of a global community of think tanks around the world that share a common set of challenges that they both organizationally and from a policy perspective. And these events are intended to engage in a discussion about the relevance, importance, and the transition that is taking place in think tanks around the world. I want to thank our partner and hosts, the Asia Society and the Asia Society Policy Institute, and it is a new and wonderful entrant onto the think tank scene, both here in the U.S. And its impact around the world. So I want to thank the Honorable Kevin Rudd for, one, being part of this program, but also spearheading the think tank here at the Asia Society. I also want to thank the extraordinary panel that we have here tonight. We had a very lively discussion in Washington, and I'm expecting an even more interesting and engaging discussion here tonight. I just want to say a few words about the Think Tanks and Civil Society program. It is, by design, a global grassroots effort to create a community of think tanks that is transnational, transpolitical, and transdisciplinary. We now and continue to conduct research and collect data on close to 7,000 think tanks. We do research on think tanks and the civil societies and countries in which they operate, and we produce the annual Global Go-To report that you have that was distributed here tonight. More importantly, we are engaged in creating both local, meaning national, regional, and global summits of think tanks to prepare them or to explore both the policy challenges and the organizational challenges they face. We've now had 25 of these meetings, and part of where we're headed is to essentially help think tanks innovate and adapt to meet the challenges that you will hear about tonight. I want to lay out five basic trends that I think will and continue to impact think tanks. Some respects, they've come into focus as a result of Brexit, as a result of Donald Trump, but I think they've been in play for the last 5 or 6 years, but have really crystallized in recent events. One, I think think tanks operate in a highly competitive and contentious marketplace, and I would suggest global marketplace of ideas. Secondly, globalization has had a profound impact and the good, bad, and ugly dimensions of it. Thirdly, I would suggest that disruptive technologies, and more importantly, when disruptive technologies meet and empower disruptive politicians or politics. Fourthly, what I see as the increased velocity of information and policy flows. So technology, globalization have accelerated the flow of information and policies, flows of information and policy around the world. And finally, not only in the United States, not only in Europe, but in Asia, in many countries, there is an increased polarization. So the current political economy requires that all think tanks, though, and those who support them, and those who use what they produce to think critically about the challenges and opportunities that this new operating environment presents to think tanks and policymakers. So I'm looking forward to hearing what our panelists have to say and the very able hands of Alessandra Stanley, who will moderate. I will not introduce each one of the panelists. There are profiles of each and pictures, so you can see who they are. And I'll move to the panel itself and turn it over to Alessandra.
Terrific. Thank you. Yes, I think we should get started right away. And I see a lot of very young people here, so this is going to be interesting to see how you see think tanks, because they're a different generation. I'm old enough to remember Rand Corporation. So here's my question for you to start. You were talking about the need for think tanks, that now more than ever in the age of alternative facts, we're going to want somewhere to go, and yet we're at the same time, my newspaper and others have been covering the problems of think tanks, that they are either seen as brains for hire, or they are lobbying for the energy, and that you can call them up. I mean, journalists always call up think tanks and say, what do we think of? And it's one thing to know what the political proclivities are, but what about the sort of financial constraints that tie them? And is it a problem, and what would you do to fix it?
Well, that's a great question to start with, and a tough one to start with as well, because it really, I think, cuts at the heart of the matter and the basic tenets of the business of think tanks. But maybe before I answer that, I would like to thank obviously our host here at the Asia Society, and of course Jim McGann himself, who really, I think, does a great public service with this. Jim had a thick head of black hair when he started this process. That's how long he's been working on this. But it really is a great public service. I think it's probably easy to lose sight of and assume that we are living in a completely uncharted territory because of the bombast that we are seeing emanating from particular capitals, because of Brexit, because of and so on and so forth, that we are in this, you know, truly scary moment, and you know, of course, the future is always scarier than the past. But I think it's worth keeping in mind, Alessandra, that this has been a long process of challenging the basic tenets of what Robert Brookings and Andrew Carnegie had in mind in the very early days of think tanks. And it is true, I think, that we should, before we can chart a path to understanding how we work our way back to a position of relevance and of respect with both policymakers as well as with the public, is that where are the challenges coming from? And I think Jim summed them up quite well, that it's the advent in many cases of technology, any number, obviously, of factors, changing philanthropic models. I suspect we'll talk about that as well. But I think it's also worth noting that some of these wounds are self-inflicted on the think tank community, and that's what we have, I think, the early opportunity to work on. Of think tanks has, you know, these affiliations with parties in this country and in other countries has certainly undercut the legitimacy of think tanks, I think, in some cases. I think it's also true that while we need to adapt to a changing environment in terms of our media strategies and how we get our messages out, it's also true that we have, in some cases, gone too far the other way. I mean, some of us have built television studios in the basement of our organizations. And while that is certainly an effective way, I think, to get our message out, it's also true that it has, in some ways, undercut the basic value of think tanks, which is, I think, correcting for what governments can't do. And Kevin mentioned that. It's long-term thinking. It's interdisciplinary thinking. And as we have become rapid reactors to the news cycle, I think it has, in some ways, challenged us. So as we reflect on how we, remain relevant, I think it is thinking about both how we undertake our research, how we fund our research and adapt to those changing models of philanthropy, but also I think carefully calibrating and not overreacting to what seems like a remarkably different environment that may actually not be quite as different as we, I think, assume it is.
A quick follow-up. Should there be rules, though? Should there be a restraint on funding? Should industry not fund you? I mean,
well, there are rules, of course, that govern think tanks, and rather strict rules. I think that what is clear based upon some of the critical insights that have been and cases that have been cast and some of the critical light that has been shed on think tanks as of late, is that transparency is clearly essential. It is essential because we are, at the end of the day, we're public servants, right? It's a business, of course, but we're all public servants. I mean, we benefit from, in this country, a privileged tax status, and therefore we are, we work in some ways for the public good. We certainly work for the public good. And so I think that, you know, in remaining true to that and remaining transparent with who funds us and where those resources are coming from, I think is absolutely essential.
Aaron, is neutrality something that is valuable, or should in fact an institute like yours be lobbying for the ideas, not lobbying for your sponsor, but lobbying for what you think is the right policy on any given issue? And you know a lot about many issues, but you know, cyber crime, proliferation, all those things. How do you see your role?
Well, I think you can do both effectively. I think you can both be a neutral organization and push for good ideas. I don't think that the two are mutually exclusive. When you think of neutrality, when I think of that, I think of that you're not for any one political stripe. And that's helpful because governments come and go. Political parties change. And if you're constantly hewing and tacking from the middle to various political stripes, I think that can actually damage your credibility along the way. But that doesn't mean that you can't have a good idea and push for it. And that certainly doesn't mean you have a good idea or a policy proposal and you try and work with government to advance that. So I don't know if that's a satisfactory answer, but in my view, I don't see the two as mutually exclusive. And in fact, if you are neutral and, on Brian's point, if you maintain credibility, if you maintain integrity, if you maintain the quality of your research, and then you have a good idea and you can reach across the aisle and you can work with political parties of all stripes, I think it actually advances your cause.
Is government the audience for you now, or do you feel like maybe that now we've seen how, let's say, Washington or the establishment is under attack, should you be reaching out to the public, and is there a way to do that if you're a think tank, to influence people beyond the policymakers? Since the policymakers, as Mr. Rudd pointed out, don't have time to read you anyway, is there someone else that you could approach?
I think that's the question of the day. How think tanks think of their audience. And in my view, I think it's a bifurcated audience now. I think the idea of universal access or sole access to policymakers or that privileged status that think tanks had is gone. I think that there's many voices now, and I think that access to policymakers is no longer a unique feature of what think tanks do. Now, to be fair, I think that there's still a very important role for think tanks in that engagement process, and certainly there is room for those closed-door briefings, and there is room for that relationship building with government or with policymakers directly. But when I say a bifurcated audience, I also mean the public generally, or the interested public. And because there is a feedback loop, right, the interested public will talk to their policymakers directly now, and they'll do so using the microphone of social media, and that is a fundamental change in our industry. Now, to add to that, I think that the way that you communicate with those two audiences is sometimes different. And so, one of the things that we've done is really, really pushed on digital, and we see a narrowing of the nexus between the work that think tanks do and the work that journalists do. I think digital storytelling is one tool. Mm-hmm. I think that infographics, short sharp videos, actually using Twitter as a social media place to have conversations and not treating it like a billboard is a sensible path forward. But the way that you engage with those two audiences is different, and sometimes what it'll mean is repackaging the ideas that you already have.
Right, interesting. Mr. Rudd, you've had the privilege of actually being in government and having to rely on policy advisors. Have you had it, was in your long and distinguished career, was there a moment where you in fact did use an idea that came from the outside, that didn't come from within your bureaucracy?
When I became Prime Minister of Australia, the first thing I did was convene what we then called a 2020 summit. And I brought together, frankly, 1,000 people from across the country in 10 issue areas for 3 days in the nation's parliament building and set them basically a number of questions. And think tanks, formally or informally, actually were very helpful in that process. The measurement of it was, out of the 100 best ideas that we distilled in terms of policy, we ended up legislating or acting on directly somewhere between 20 and 30. And some have actually been very solid, enduring initiatives. So that of itself was kind of, for me, an indication that if you shake the tree hard enough as a public policy maker, then actually some apples do fall to the ground. If you, A, frame the question correctly, and B, in this gathering of 100 flowers bloom, 100 schools of thought contend, an ability to then harvest the apples and then make sure that they're translated into the public policy process. In the foreign policy domain, which I'm sort of more familiar with, I would always, even in office, make a point of having on one side of the table the stuff, for example, produced by the International Crisis Group in Brussels, not just because my compatriot Gareth Evans was then its president, but because basically with a large staff funded by Soros, this actually tended to cover the field. It's had its ups and downs in terms of its performance over the years, but frankly, any think tank does. That, for me, was a useful, as it were, rolling corrective on South China Sea policy, Middle East stuff, where, frankly, we're dealing with levels of complexity beyond this little bear's brain's ability to cope. And so that was very useful as well. The last thing I'd say in response to your question, though, is before you all start slitting your wrists here in the United States about the state of your think tanks, it's bloody good, okay? You've got a bunch of really smart people out there, and you have a large number of them, which have long ancestral histories. This is a Rockefeller institution in which you currently sit at the moment. But I always puzzle about this. If you took away the Carnegies and the Rockefellers and the Fords and the, sorry, not the Fords, the Brookings, the Carnegies and the Rockefellers, and look at, as we've discussed prior to coming on stage, long-term funding basis for this operation, where does it lie without running into your first question, which is deep and fundamental compromise and therefore the integrity of the intellectual product and the policy product, rendering them redundant over time. But don't think that everything that's going on in this country is somehow deeply flawed. I think it's reasonably healthy, but with deep structural changes, as Jim indicated in his introduction.
Oh. Mr. Master. Let's just pretend that the current president of the United States, the newly elected president of the United States, turns to you and says, tell me one thing I'm doing wrong and tell me how to fix it. And he's actually going to listen to the answer. Do you have one thing that you think really should be corrected and can be corrected?
And if so, could you tweet it to him?
Yes. Again, it is really hard because the notion you're talking about is that the assumption that I think all of the think tanks that we know labor under is that there is a certain rationality here and that you're going to point things out that are not just insights but that are things that lead to actual policy implementation, et cetera, that are workable. And I think the kind of things that you'd like to say to the president now have much more to do with, in my mind, with setting goals, with being clear about what you're trying to do. And I think it is something relevant for the think tank community as well, that if we assess it up, I'll get back to your question, but I'm going kind of sideways. If we assess that the problem that think tanks suffer from is the problem that any, what we would call mediating institution suffers from, the ability of people like the current president to speak directly to what they see as their constituency, and that the authority of a validator such as a think tank or a church or a trade union or any or journalism has been challenged, and that you don't need these intermediary mediating authorities in order to give heft and weight to your ideas. If you aren't thinking that, and if that's part of that disruption that we've talked about, then it's very difficult to come up with a discussion that talks about, well then, what are the pieces of society, if you will, that are going to be used to make this into real policy? So you find yourself having a discussion about goals, about things like trust, That is to say, what is an institution, what is a think tank trying to do through the sheer brilliance of its empirical data to say, this is the way the world works, we slap ourselves in the forehead, or we take 23 of these ideas and make them into policy. That's an assumption, that there's a kind of an empirical agreement about the validity of these ideas and the doability of what comes out of that. So the fundamental problem I would try to address is, in which way, if you are a political leader, under the influence of globalization, under the influence of disruptive technologies, the velocity of information, what is the way in which those people who know many things about the outside world can be constructive in building enough trust to make a way in which those ideas can be applied? And I think one of the difficulties that I had, working in the government for many years, but also am trying to deal with in the think tank where I now work at the East-West Institute, is to come up with the means by which we don't have to rely on the government to take these ideas, to accept them, and to go through that process of selling them to a kind of a public, but to act on them ourselves. One thing we haven't talked about on the assumption here is that, you know, think tanks tend to, let's say, a classic think tank will produce studies of something, and this study goes to a committee on the Hill, and et cetera. We do a lot of back channel. So we do a lot of things where we are actually active doing things, and that's a different role for an institution like ours. But what it does is it at least attempts to try to make the field a little bit different in the discussion when you're talking to the president about what can be done.
But so back channel to whom?
Well, the back channel is, you know, if, you know, we believe that Clemenceau said that war is too important to be left to the generals, and I would add that as a recovering diplomat myself, diplomacy is much too important to be left to the diplomats, that you're not just saying, here are the tools, government, work with the tools, but here are the alternative, here, let us identify some of the alternative ways in which we can bring people together to talk about mechanisms of, say, diplomacy. That is to say, think tanks themselves are engaged in more than just thought.
Can I add to that as well when you're through?
Yes, please.
And when you're through.
No, just okay. The main point I'm trying to say is we are not just supplying things for government. We're also exploring ways in which the disruption that's taken place needs to be filled by institutions like ours to contribute to the discussion by talking, for example, with foreign governments, with business communities, with academic communities, with social groups around the world. Mm-hmm. Please.
It really comes down to a question of what the agreed function of a given think tank is. And
exactly.
There is a scope. I'd put it in three terms if you're dealing with public policy. One is your classic academic study, where frankly a lot of facts, not alternative facts, but facts may be in contention in order to actually drill down to the reality of what actually objectively is occurring. Country X, situation Y, challenge Z, in the United States. Second is actually going from facts to policy, which is, given these facts and the following policy challenges, problems and opportunities presenting themselves, how do we therefore as this institution provide the policy makers in this country or in others with a range of options to deal with that, to maximize the opportunities and frankly to minimize the risks? Assuming, by the way, there's a common set of values underpinning these propositions. Come back to that later if you wish. But the third is what has just been discussed here by Cameron, and we do this all the time. We're the Asia Society. We build bridges between this country and the various countries of Asia. We are directly engaged in rolling forms of interlocutory diplomacy, second-track diplomacy, where we're working with governments all the time. Let me give you an example. We're currently here trying to develop a concept of a Northeast Asian carbon market through our sustainability program within the Policy Institute, linking China, Japan, and Korea. We're doing so in direct engagement with the Chinese NDRC, National Development Reform Commission, their equivalents in Tokyo, their equivalents in Seoul. And so we are working on a rolling basis with them, the object of which is to produce A, something which can objectively assist with bringing carbon emissions down, B, adding a bit of, by way of a confidence and security building measure between three otherwise problematic relationships, mm-hmm. and between the three in Asia, which goes to one of our fundamental values here at the Asia Society. But then C, socializing it into the politics and the public policy processes of those countries. So I think the functions of each think tank may differ. We don't do much of the first. We're not into primary factual analysis. We use the product of a whole bunch of other think tanks in doing the second, in producing policy recommendations, but we are very much into the prosecution business as well.
Speaking of carbon, but now do you feel that your project is endangered because the United States is going in a different direction?
Well, again, I think that's where think tanks, writ broadly, have a huge role. The government of the United States, democratically elected, has said that they are going to rip up their commitment to the Paris Agreement and defund a range of initiatives embraced by the Obama administration and reverse a number of executive orders, which relate particularly to coal-fired power stations. These are not insignificant, grant you that. But if you have think tanks, and we're just one of a large number in this country who are concerned about sustainability in general and climate change in particular, we therefore would see, if that is one of our values, and we do believe in sustainability and within that climate change action, we then see ourselves as having an audience with public opinion, as you indicated before, with state and subnational governments in the United States, which are significant actors, with corporations who are worried about their shareholders and their consumers saying, we don't care what President Trump says, we actually believe the science and we're going to act. And if you, Morgan Stanley, or you, Standard Chartered, don't do the right thing through the transparent public reporting through your annual reports, then we're going to punish you. And finally, we act with foreign governments, as we are with the three offshore, who are saying they're still going to work in accordance with the Paris Agreement. So our job is to work, shall I say, flexibly mm-hmm. in response to changing political and policy dynamics within the United States, which there are a number I've recently observed mm-hmm. in the last 4 or 5 days.
Well, that's what I'm hoping that you will all address a little bit. This is your occasion to specifically say what you, if you had the opportunity, what would you ask the new administration to do? Let's say you can get Jared on the phone.
Well, I would definitely ask the new president. I do not like Arnold Schwarzenegger as the new host of Celebrity Apprentice, and I think I would ask him to change
that. He'd agree with you.
I think I would ask him to change that. It's not working. It's not working. Look, I think that this is a great audience, I think, here in New York because it is inherently global. And we tend to think, sitting in Washington, we tend to think that we're the belly button of the universe, and what happens in Washington is the only thing that happens around the world. And so I think that as we are debating all of the issues that I think that have come up already, climate change on down to security issues to economic issues, what's clear, and I think Kevin certainly got to this in his point, is that, you know, there is certainly a pushback to this era of globalization, it is an inevitable force that is pushing around the world for good and for ill. Right? So we understand the security challenges behind that, but we also understand the many benefits that globalization has brought, both on the security side as well as, literally billions of people have been brought out of poverty as a result of globalization. But it's also true that, we assume, I think, in think tanks that government is our sole interlocutor, and that, you know, even our communication strategies, that our outreaches are all ultimately aimed at influencing government. But I think increasingly, and I think this is a new role for think tanks, that, and again, this is to build on Kevin's point, that there are many actors now on the global stage at the subnational level as well, private industry being one, large philanthropists being another. I mean, you think about the influence that Bill Gates has had on global public health around the world. I mean, how many millions of people are alive because of that one man's decision-making with respect to his philanthropy? So you have these massive consortia and I think cross-cutting interests. How can a think tank play a more operational role in organizing these constituencies more effectively? So let me give you an example. Of a rather odd role that a think tank has played, and it happens to be the one that I know best, at Stimson. So we were asked by a government in sub-Saharan Africa to come in and look at some of the challenges surrounding the porosity of borders around their country. So you had drug trade, terrorist flows, counterfeit goods, conventional arms, small arms, that fueled conflict, refugees. We sat down with them and by bringing in kind of various actors, came up with a strategy to manage border security. So we essentially gave policy recommendations. They came back to us and said, this is fantastic. Now what do we do? And so we sat with them and ultimately we ended up at the Stimson Center adopting a rhino sanctuary in sub-Saharan Africa. Now, why a rhino sanctuary? It's a 100-square-kilometer zone that has all of the same attributes and all of the same border challenges that the country had. And so we essentially built a public-private partnership on behalf of the government that brought in the likes of Nokia and Ericsson and defense technology firms and local technology providers, programmers, to build a solution to this challenge. And it's just one of the few parks today that where poaching is actually going down instead of going up. And now the government has taken what they learned and what we in fact learned through executing in that, and we have now managed to work to scale it up at the level. And we in turn, by doing or learning ourselves and able to apply and refine policy proposals to others. But it is not just aimed at this one government. It is aimed at a consortia of aid providers, of private companies, of across the board. So that is our new, for us at least, that is our new audience. It's right. It's no longer influencing the president who is sitting in the Oval Office. It's influencing all manner of individuals.
But it was the government that came to you. It was the government of the
who initiated in this case. Yeah, right. Who initiated in this case.
Exactly. I suppose what we're saying back to you is there's nothing unclean about that. You know, your hypothesis to start with was conflicts. And I've read all the stuff in the New York Times and good on you. That's what you do. But, you know, so long as these institutions are transparent about their values, number one, really important, and transparent about their funding sources, both generically and per project, frankly, I don't see a big problem. Because people will soon conclude if the piper is just, paying for the tune, as it were, and you're just producing a report for Government X, I mean, people are going to reach that conclusion in peer review within 12 months, and there goes your reputation.
Yeah,
which indicates one last point that I think agrees here is that there's room for a lot of different types of institutions, and in fact, it's necessary for the think tank community to be diverse, because some people are going to play off of each other and have different roles, so that to ask the question, are you being fair, some people are advocates. Some think tanks will be clear in their advocacy of certain areas. Some think tanks like ours will talk with people we don't actually like very much in the interest of finding common ground that we can use to prevent conflict. So we like to think that we complement one another even if we're acting in very different ways, and the key is being transparent about what our particular think tank does.
And should there be a monitor? Should you be checking on this, Mr. McGann? Should someone be monitoring your levels of transparency? I know that is a category, but there's no. It's really being reviewed by your peers. Is there any other way?
Well, I mean, I'm not on the panel, but I'll answer the question. I mean, there has been and I have been an advocate for years in a project that's called Quality, Independence, and Integrity, and the basic position based on some of the articles coming out of your former newspaper, the New York Times, that think tanks need to be ahead of that, and the issues that have been identified in terms of transparency, but the integrity and the quality and the impact and the currency is really affected by the credibility and how an institution effectively manages quality, its independence, and its integrity. And there are ways of doing that, and we've identified, what are the basic areas that, in terms of research, in terms of the financial stewardship of the monies provided, the firewalls between the researchers, et cetera. But there are a number of policies that institutions can put in place without a lot of problem, and that they can, and what where there's a general movement now is to buy into those principles.
And I would just add to that, Alessandra, I mean, the ultimate arbiter of this is the market itself, and because I getting to their points that we ultimately appeal for support, obviously beyond the walls of our respective institutions, and if we become a propagator of fake news, then that quickly becomes known across the funding community, and your reputation is really, I mean, we have no capital aside from our reputations.
Tell me about Silicon Valley. Because on one hand, that's where the money is, and they certainly believe in new ideas and change. And on the other hand, they also want to replace you with artificial intelligence. And they also seem to be very confident of their own ability to think through problems as opposed to asking the more learned, experienced people. Have you had experiences trying to fundraise with Silicon Valley or work for Silicon Valley? Oh, you were nodding.
Yeah, we do. And Silicon Valley is not a thing. It's a collection of institutions and individuals, and institutions that are not just money-making institutions, Stanford University, et cetera. So that in the relationship that diverse groups have with Silicon Valley, what you run across is, for example, donors, high net worth individuals who care very much that what they do is linked into the kind of conflict prevention that we do. So, and likewise, if you study questions that we care about in cybersecurity, mm-hmm. as we are very engaged, they're very engaged.
Right.
We're answering questions that they might have about encryption, that they might have about Internet of Things and the impact of different problems that they might think are interesting problems of developing hardware, software, where we are able to bring to the table our relations with Chinese who think a certain way about the Internet, or Europeans and data privacy, et cetera. So I find it, rather than saying this is somehow a challenge, these are partners in many ways who are very interested in actually making think mm-hmm. tanks of various types relevant.
Mm. Yeah. And yet you have this, you mentioned Stanford, you have these institutions that are so well funded that also think of themselves now as think tanks. In fact, the latest gift, the $400 million, that's basically a scholarship to create a think tank on campus so that the smartest people in the world will gather and think through all these problems. It sounds like Stanford wants to put you out of business.
I strongly disagree. Stanford wants us to work with them.
Yeah.
They probably want to squeeze us for all we know, but they're acknowledging that we, the institutions we represent, mm-hmm. have diverse things we bring to the table and approaches that makes them stronger. So I see nothing but good coming out of this.
There's a generic principle, though, which is true in this data-rich world in which we live, and often analysis-poor world in which we live. There is going to be high competition between those of us engaged in the analysis of data and the development of evidence-based policy in response to data across the institutions. That's a reality. But kind of my response to that is, you know, let 100 flowers bloom, let 100 schools of thought contend. And this country is kind of built on competition. You can have competition for ideas as well. And so I'm a senior fellow at Belfer at Harvard. You just ranked them, I think, number one, is that right?
That is correct.
University think tanks. And so, but these folks we collaborate with all the time in this institution, and they do with other institutions. So I did the same with CSIS in Washington, with Chatham House and others. It's much, shall I say, more interdisciplinary, interinstitutional and interdisciplinary, than perhaps it once was when these were freestanding monoliths or juggernauts, leviathans sort of lumbering along with walls around them. Don't come to the CFR if you haven't been a member for the last 26 years and wear the right tie. I think the key thing always, though, and I'd emphasize this, is for the institutions to be absolutely upfront about what their underpinning values are. Not just the ones about integrity and empirical research and those sort of things, but AEI in Washington, for example, will represent a bunch of values I don't agree with. But I'm very happy they're there, as long as they're transparent about what they're on about. Similarly with Brookings, be very clear about what you're on about. If you're basically a soft Democrat institution or a hard Republican institution, just be clear about it in terms of the policy propositions. And that's a good thing, because they're all out there in the debate. I think when you get muffled value statements that you have a problem of, shall I say, insufficient transparency mm-hmm. as well.
Okay. Now, I'm wondering if we want to take some questions, because we've got a big audience here. And I would like to see a show of hands. Anyone have a question? Okay, so I have a question for the audience. Especially the younger ones, when you want to know something, where do you go? What's your first? I'm looking at you, young lady, with the white sweater on. When you want to understand a problem, let's say global warming. Well, or some other volunteer. Where do you...
Now terrified.
I want to see how distant you are from the people who are actually seeking information. So, okay, now I need a volunteer. There we go. Where do you go for your information?
I usually use the news app on my phone or just Google something.
And when you want to research an issue, you want to know where you stand on, say, global warming or nuclear proliferation, where do you go? Do you go to Wikipedia? I mean, how do you decide where you're going to find your source?
Personally, I like the pages of a lot of different institutions and things on Facebook, and I read a lot of stuff that are on there. So I usually try to align myself with those organizations that I stand by. Mm-hmm. And so if I see something on that another organization has written, I get my information from there and usually will build upon it that way. Not always from the same source, but if I see something that I stand with, then I'm able to grab that information and kind of compile it my own way.
That's interesting. I hadn't even thought of that. Is Facebook now the way you get your message across?
One of the ways.
But is it, I mean, it used to be, I think, perhaps I'm flattering myself, but it used to be being quoted in the Washington Post, the New York Times, right? That used to be. Mm-hmm. But now is that been superseded by things like Facebook?
Depends on the subject, I think, and depending on...
Well, you're all in foreign policy, so...
I think you need to go to where the audience is, right? And so it used to be, I think the model was one of we're going to push all of our content, be it books or papers, and we're going to put everything on our website, the end, right? And if you build it, they will come. And I don't think that that's good enough anymore. I think we're in a world of syndication now. So if we won't just hit Facebook, but we'll go everywhere with our content and with the view of trying to engage the audience. And we'll push our stuff on multiple different platforms. So it's not just our core corporate website anymore, but we'll take that same story that runs on our core corporate website and syndicate it in 5 or 6 different places, and we'll push it on social, and we'll use Facebook, again, to build out that audience.
Are any of you guilty of clickbait?
What does that mean?
Clickbait is when you come up with a kind of sexy... title or précis that will get attention but isn't actually probably the most important thing you want to say, but it's just a way to get attention.
No, we set out here to be as boring as possible. That's our deliberate formulated policy. Be gray, be boring.
I would argue that our approach is trying to, as you said, use as many of the media as possible and to say, we have some people who pay a lot of attention to us that don't read, but who look at our videos.
Right.
Now, when you have a video, do you put your video on your website and forget about it? Or do you make other efforts to try to make that video available?
Right.
So that is a series of challenges that I think just underscores what you said, that you can't rely on one thing. You can't say, oh, we're going with Facebook.
Right.
Oh, we're going with the New York Times. We want them all.
Right.
And so the challenge here is trying to figure out in which way the young woman here, what makes her trust certain institutions over others? Is it the presentation? Is it the validation that certain people give to it? You know, exploring the question of how do you decide who you trust, who do you align with? That's something, when I mentioned trust before, that we're struggling
right.
with and are always available, and it's part of the element of the media you use.
Right.
It's part of the element of the validators you have, and part of the element of the actual substance of what you're talking about.
If I can just add
yes.
to that, I would also say that, I just don't want the point to get lost because it was made earlier, but it really is, I mean, the audience for think tanks is segmented as well. I mean, it's very true that the 95% of the work that Stimson engages in, we don't need you all to know about it. Yeah? We do not need everyone in the room to know about this. And so we may be, in some cases, we want to get a wide message out and really push for educational purposes and just for building knowledge for the sake of knowledge, which we believe is a good thing. In other cases, however, we may be saying, look, we're after a particular you know, that this information needs to end up in these individuals' hands. Sometimes you are the, you are the consumer. It's media, which in turn is a bank shot to another audience. Or it may just be those six individuals that are, you know, decision makers on Capitol Hill who we believe need, you know, nonpartisan, clean information. They need the facts in order to make a decision. And in that case, it's, you know, it's an educational outreach to those individuals, or in an administration, or in a foreign government, or in, you know, an industry association.
Right. What about, oh, we have a question there.
It seems that we're almost like in a...
Microphone coming.
We're seeming to be entering a information war period, that we're trying to find out how folks find trust in what they read on the internet when they're researching an issue. And so Scopes has been one of the few places that you can take an article and ask Scopes if they think it's a bona fide article or not, if it's really good, if it's true or not. It seems that I'm looking around, and you as a think tank organization have a rating and ranking of how you look at yourselves through a peer lens. And that's new news to me. So it would seem to me that that your research, when it gets published on the internet, could have a kind of a fandango, green tomatoes kind of ranking, that this is from this XYZ think tank, and this is how this XYZ think tank is, if it's an enterprise institute, that it's over here in hard right, and if it's a soft democratic institute, it's over here on that. And so you could give us the uninitiated, like myself, internet explorer, some more guidance.
Is that possible to do? Can you control how you're viewed on the internet? Can you get sucked into some meme that is using your information to make a point that you would never have concluded? Does that happen, and how do you combat it?
Well, you just react. If you see your own data being misused, then you as an institution have a responsibility to say that is a non-inaccurate inference drawn from our data. It's an inaccurate presentation of our policy recommendations. So we under those circumstances would enter the public space in force. Secondly, the advantage of the social media revolution is that we have platforms for doing that. For example, last night here we had 3 hours town hall meeting. This place was full to the back on Trump implications for Asia, China, India, North Korea, Iran, rest of Middle East. And it was webcast. It was live tweeted. We used Facebook. And we told the media, the conventional people who do those things. And for us, as we were saying before, each of those media platforms was essential. That's our best way also of ensuring that what we have put out there is transparently obvious to those who consume the product, because we've used it through multiple platforms. You can listen to it, you can see it, you can watch it, or you can see it later and whatever. And that's a good thing. The lady, I think, asked a really good question, though, about Scopes, which is, do you have effectively a way, if I've understood it correctly, instantaneously fact-checking stuff which comes out? Frankly, I think that's a great value added to the public. I'm glad that the debate about fact-checking has reached the stage that it has in the United States of America and in my own country. And if there's one big challenge for all of us now in what I describe as sort of the age of postmodernism, whereby facts don't count anymore, empiricism is for fuddy-duddies, and rationalism is kind of a Baroque interest, is the establishment among us as a society of think tanks, that there is a basic common epistemology here to how we assert facts, prove facts, establish facts, and reach rational conclusions. Because what I fear is happening across all the political systems I'm familiar with is we now have opinions ultimately detached from any factual base. And that
Speaking
is cancerous
of which,
in a
I'm
democracy.
Going to stop. I'm going to ask you a question and then come to you. If you were the head of the Pew Foundation or the Pew Institute and you now had a president who was reading your report incorrectly, and then you go on social media and you go everywhere saying, that's not what my report says and it doesn't matter, what would you do at his in that case? I mean, if it was your institute that had been, whose information had been misinterpreted, let's be generous. Mm-hmm.
Well, as I was indicating before, if it was mine, and I know a little bit about Pew, but and I know some folks who are there, is that you would engage in full force and full vigor. And if there has been, frankly, a fiddling with the ethics of the business, which is we seek objectively as we can to produce facts which are measurable, secondly, to derive through rational processes policy responses to given facts, and then they are simply, as it were, hijacked by someone who's running a non-fact, non-rational, non-empirical agenda in the public policy space, then the only thing you can do is attack and shred their reputation. And that's what you do. So we're in the political space too, whether we
so
like it or
So you're going to attack the president's reputation?
You're going to attack
On that issue, yes.
He's going to attack his use of that issue.
Absolutely.
Ad hominem doesn't work, but
no,
sure.
No, on the issue, yeah. Because it's a provable thing. Here is what we said. This is why we said it. This is how it's been used. That is simply unfactual or unethical.
I mean, the problem we're all dealing with is that we can, amongst ourselves, can all agree on it, but there's some part of the population that doesn't care what we say.
I suppose what I'm saying in democracies, and this is where think tanks have a huge opportunity, challenge, and I think responsibility is, the Enlightenment project, which we've all signed up to in the last couple of centuries, reason and empiricism, is itself under challenge in the West. How I feel and how I hate is now more important to that which I know. In these Saturday protests here in the United States, which I casually observed, walking along this pavement beside them, as the president of an independent think tank, you don't want to be actually walking in one. It was this great sign which said, make America think again. And you know, it's not about America, it's about the West, in my view, in terms of... But I think we have, as this grouping of folks, foreign policy or whatever, public policy, inland drainage policy or whatever, is to defend the basis of knowledge and how we reach it, because that, I think, is deeply under threat at present.
You had a question.
Yeah, the question is about how do you assess the research and development for the...
Oh, thank you. Yes, regarding the question of assessing a better research and development for the social media use, unfortunately, I think the social media has been invented for a better communication, the Web 2.0, but it has fallen into the original trap of the Web 1.0. Because today, if I'm in Twitter, for example, I read something without knowing the user, 95% of the time I know who tweeted that. And guess what? The guess is always right, like 95% of the time. So it has become, I guess, a banalistic way of communication. Like if you type something on Google, the rule of Twitter and Facebook has been dragged down to the web 1.0 phase. So how do you assess a better way of using it as a communication? Because people fell onto the trap of non-communication through these social media networks. Thank you.
I just want to make sure I understand. Do you mean that information is siloed, that people only hear what they... see what they are predisposed.
Well, you have three groups, tribute groups. Like if you follow, usually there is the press, politics, and think tanks. But inside of each group, besides reading who wrote what, like inside of politics, you know if it was a Democrat, if it was a Republican, if it was like a governance person that is not in politics. Governance and politics are different. When it is a think tank person, you know, when it is the UN, when it is somebody from the private sector.
I see what you're
saying. But we're not falling onto the main rule that has been established for the Web 2.0, communication. It's just a tool of information. Is there a way to better that?
I have no idea. What do you think?
I wish you hadn't turned to me.
I can jump on that one. Okay. I mean, so Look, there's a couple of issues I think that I'd like to try and pull together here. So you raised the issue of kind of quality and to make sure that whatever's being said is accurate. And think tanks, we've got a number of tools in place to do that. I don't know how you guys operate, but everything we do is subject to double-blind peer review. For our research, and then we've got an in-house expert at the director level who okays everything that goes out the door. So if it's going out with our stamp on it, it's been double-blind reviewed, and then we've had an independent expert on staff review it as well. Then we would take that and we would package it on social. Right, but we use that as an opportunity to engage in a conversation. So, and one of the things that we did is we retooled our entire staff in order to be able to do that because we didn't have that capacity. We were using Twitter like a billboard. Here's a great paper, the end. But now, if you saw something and you wanted to talk with us, you could tweet at us. And we would actually be literally engaging in a conversation around that. And we try and bring people into that. So I think that they're two different things, but the way that you engage and the quality of your engagement are certainly related.
Yeah?
It's close, but yes, it's, I think, a better thing to do because it engages more the people who uses the platforms like Twitter and Facebook rather than just seeing them as a standard Google search page. For information.
No, and you know, again, with the way that we've restaffed, so here's an interesting story. So I'm learning as we go too. So we do have a television studio, but it's on the second floor, Brian.
So it's
not in the basement. But no, we had, so I live in a Commonwealth country, so the Queen is still the head of state. And the Queen's representative was coming to visit the office, and we were doing, actually talking about engagement, we're doing a high school essay competition on climate change. So to try and get young people rallied around this topic. And also to get our message out there to the next generation. And the Queen's representative was going to announce it for us on social media. And so I had brought Her Honor up to the waiting room, expecting us to have three cameras set up and lights and all of the film crew. And when the film crew wasn't there for this taping, I got really worried. So I had asked Her Honor just to wait. I was going to go get the film crew and come running back. And I ran into the film crew, which was one of our social staff, who pulled out an iPhone from her pocket, put it on a tripod, pulled out a tablet, and had the tablet running an app that was a teleprompter. Yeah. Within 15 seconds, we were now engaging in high-quality film that was packaged and delivered in 45 seconds after the film hit was done. So we're all learning, but the technology has fundamentally changed the way that people consume information and the way that think tanks need to engage with their audience, because if you treat it like a billboard or you just fire out PDFs, you're dead in the water. Mm-hmm.
I'm Peter Evans with Expert File. How do you see your relationship with the media changing over the next while? I know it's a broad question, but I want to hear what you have to say about that. I mean, I'm particularly blown away by seeing a new show launched by CNN the other night and with Van Jones, and then he's got Jeffrey Lord on, Kel Surprise. You know, these are surrogates that have, in many ways, influence public opinion in a big way, and they're not the best experts to put out on public policy. So how do you see yourselves relating to the media, both at a local and even the global media, to get your message out?
Yeah, it's a great question. And, you know, I've always seen the media as we're frenemies, I think, right? But in some ways we compete with one another, but we also have a symbiotic relationship where we so rely on one another. So I've had conversations with journalists that say, you think tank guys, you're irrelevant now. We can do that. We're our own think tank now in journalism, and we've kind of, you know, we've supplanted your, but at the same time, when they are overwhelmed with fake news and they're trying to, you know, parse the facts, then they need trusted sources to go to and call up and say, Aaron, you know, can you, is this, what do you think of this? Is this truth or fiction? And I guess the other thing I would say, and it gets back to the video, to the studio and your, I have no fundamental objection to, we also have one, but the challenge, the point I think is that, you know, we get to the over-reliance on and the over-focus of communicating a message can at times supplant your core mission, right? Our core mission is you know, the generation of knowledge, facts, and research, and then we want to use the media as a mechanism to, or social media as a mechanism to get that message out into the right hands. But you know, I fear that if we get disbalanced and we try to do what they are trying to do, is then we're vomiting on our own shoes, to use a very crude analogy.
Very effective.
Okay.
Effective. I would add
I'm wrestling with the image.
There are many different things that many different think tanks do, and we do not do what they do. We do conflict prevention. So that in when we have work that we do overseas in trying to get people to anticipate problems before they become problems, and to get people to trust each other so that 5 years from now they can have a discussion, much of what we do is what we would call below the waterline. So I'm stepping around your question about dealing with the media. A lot of times we don't want people to know at the right time. There's a lot of room for a lot of different relations with the media that go beyond the obvious who knows who has what function. And we tend to see the media much more as partners rather than competitors, because usually the media, whether social, whether progressive, whether foreign, whether domestic, is curious about something we're doing rather than competing with us for coming up with the truth. So just an illustration of the fact that as we talk about the future of think tanks, I think it's important just to remember there is not Over time, there will be, I think, even more diversity among the basic role of think tanks, and that will mean that the relationship with, for example, the media is going to be quite varied.
Just to endorse that, for example, this institution, for quite a number of years, way before I came here, we engaged in a very deep second-track exercise between the United States and the Iranians before anything ever happened. Other institutions are doing the same, but we did it. We'd never tell the media that. It just blows the whole show out of the water.
Exactly.
Interesting news, but that's not our public policy mission. Right. However, if our public policy mission is on a particular matter, say, do we think free trade is good for the world and America, then we are into, shall I say, evangelization mode. We see the media as our natural partners. So it's horses for courses. Is that an Australian expression?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
It's a good one.
Okay. And that is, I've got to ask these things on my way through. I see blank faces. I know I've actually gone into dialect. It is particular to each set of circumstances that you choose to engage or not engage. The more fundamental question, answer to the gentleman's point before, is whither the media and the collapse of the business model. With prints, Times, but and the rest. But in time, frankly, the electronics, certainly the broadcast electronics, and now, of course, even the cables. So now, when they disappear in their current form, and we've had this model of public media now for about 170 years, maybe 200 years, then what do we all do? And for me, that's a profound question. And the related one for me, which comes out of the earlier question here, sir, is it's great that we are all putting out our stuff through multiple media platforms when we are in the communications business, as opposed to trying to be private about what we're doing. But as I see the danger emerging here and in my country as well, once we lose any common platforms for common national discourse about any public policy subject, and one tribe of social media consumers will read that stuff, and the other tribe of social media consumers will read that stuff, and never the twain shall meet, then we are in a very difficult place in terms of the sustainability of our democratic projects. And that for think tanks is deeply relevant as well, as we set up three contending kingdoms in a particular country.
Yeah. One more question, and then I have a final question.
I have the mic here.
Oh, there you go. Yes, sorry.
The first thing I want to do is assure you that I'm 29 years old. I just happen to look very old for my age.
Just to be bad lighting, I know.
It appears that underlining the entire discussion here is a belief that the human mind is wholly rational. And we know that that's not the case. For example, reading Nick Kristof's column today about the executive order precluding any funding relating to any organization that even mentions abortion results in a very emotional response. And his column did that. If you were trying to persuade, let's say, Michael R. Pence, that prohibiting this funding will actually result in more deaths and more abortions, do you frame your papers that are submitted to these governmental leaders to take into account the emotional content on which they base their ultimate decision making?
Well, you go to the basis of knowledge there, and let me make some partisan comments for a moment, and then I'll argue against myself to try and put myself back into bipartisan territory. Public politics, and you're talking about that here in this country, is essentially an appeal to either the cerebral cortex or to the amygdala in the construction of the human brain. That's the problem. Those of us who believe that we're both empiricists and rationalists, leaving aside the debate between the two, are engaging a cerebral cortex, one form or another, to produce a series of inductions and deductions. That's the methodology. The conduct of public politics, and not just today, but in previous periods, has been in various measures of that, in various measures simply resorting to fear, flight and fright, and the whole range of basic emotions which give rise to given actions. But if I look at your revolutionary history in this country, it's a very good history, the whole period of your founding fathers. These were folks who are in the fight as patriots, hollering and shooting in a very amygdala-based operation, based on a series of deeply cerebral enterprises in terms of what you were working on through the Continental Congress and the Declaration of Independence at the very same time. So in your tradition, you have this marvellous, frankly, combination of what I describe as the two robust phenomenon of a well-thought-out reasoned propositions for why you describe yourself as objectively, not just emotionally, as a city on a hill. But what I see today is, not just here, but across the collective West, is the triumph of the amygdala, particularly by one side of politics, which seeks to appear to those emotions. I used to say in Australian politics, you know, fear is a very powerful emotion and its capacity to overwhelm hope is formidable. And so many people in the political process who have mastered the neuroscience of communications will always be seeking to be harnessing the animals of fear in order to defeat, shall I say, the policy propositions of hope and alternative futures. To answer your specific question about Pence, don't know him, don't know what would work. But I think people on the rational side need to think about emotions as well.
He would need a bolt of lightning from heaven. Because no statistics you could possibly give him. But anyway, we have run out of time, but thank you for being here. Thank you all for helping us understand what you do. And it's been a great pleasure. And thank you for hosting us.